My name is Stuart Cohen. I'm a Hofstra MPH candidate, and today I'll be talking about evaluation of pulmonary embolism in pregnancy. Pulmonary embolism is a leading cause of maternal mortality and morbidity. This is because of several reasons, including pregnancy is a high, and pregnancy causes elder and riskier. Recently, we've seen elder and riskier pregnancies, especially as there's societal factors and use of advanced medical technology. Pulmonary embolism is a clot in the lungs that prevents blood flow from going the heart to the lungs, and it can be deadly. Mortality is up to 30% untreated, and it could go down to 1% with timely treatment. But treatment carries risks of bleeding events, among other things, so accurate and timely diagnosis is essential to understand what's going on to treat disease. And here's a picture on the left. Let me see. Here's a pointer. You see this? Okay. Here's a picture of a pulmonary embolism blocking a vessel in the lungs. And here, the most common etiology is these clots actually come up from the legs, go to the heart, and then go into the lungs. And this could be deadly if not treated. The diagnosis of pulmonary embolism can be very challenging, especially in pregnancy. Advanced imaging evaluation is how we directly visualize pulmonary embolism, but has risks to the mother and the fetus. Unfortunately, people haven't decided exactly the best way to evaluate this, and there's seven diagnostic clinical pathways proposed as guidelines to evaluate for this disease. The problem, in part, is because this is a difficult population to study, and there's a lot of limited data. So overall, the whole research focus I'm going to be talking about today is pulmonary embolism in pregnancy. And I think the idea is there's multiple methodologies used to address clinical concerns from multiple angles, though primarily we'll be talking about one, comparing these different guidelines. So what have we done? We used decision science methods to determine which of these seven guidelines is the best. We've gotten some local cohort data, which is very granular, gives us a lot of information to answer certain questions you really need a lot of patient-level data on, such as radiation dose, imaging characteristics, and clinicians ordering characteristics. And finally, we're also doing a project with national claims data. This is for problems that don't require as granular data, but we need large numbers across the country. And this is a project we're doing, understanding the key drivers of outcomes in pregnant women with pulmonary embolism. But today, primarily, we'll be talking about the decision science methods. In general, before we talk about anything else, I just want to talk about what makes for good research. I think it's collaboration and combination of a lot of factors. Mentorship is very important. You really have to work hard to get the knowledge in place to understand the situation you're dealing with, to build good teams. You really have to work hard. Those teams should have diversity of viewpoints. You always have to be humble to understand that you could be wrong and think outside the box. Plan in advance, deal with challenges, and be willing to adapt. I built a team of all different people, and I think this is important for you to do well in your projects, and I'm always happy to talk about how to do this. I've been lucky enough working on this for about 3 years to have some publications related to this and other manuscripts in progress. And most importantly, I've been lucky enough to have some funding. If anyone wants to talk afterwards about opportunities for grant funding, how do you go about it, I'm happy to talk about that whole path, because if you've never done it, it can be a challenge, but once you've done it a couple of times, you learn a couple tricks along the way. Not to say it's easy, but you learn some tricks. So how do we evaluate for pulmonary embolism? Somebody today walks into the emergency room. We use a combination of clinical diagnostic tests, being usually Wells criteria, and a blood test, being the D-dimer. This decides if we get this definitive imaging. Here's a picture of a pulmonary embolism. This dark area is clot blocking the main pulmonary artery, the right and the left pulmonary artery. So regularly in a non-pregnant population, we know what we do. We assess someone's risk. If it's low, medium, or high. If it's high risk, no matter what, we always get definitive imaging with a CAT scan. If it's low risk, we do a second test called a D-dimer blood test. If that's negative, we don't have to worry about the disease. If it's positive, you get this imaging test. And intermediate, it could kind of go either way. It's a little bit more complex of character. But in pregnancy, it doesn't really work this way. The diagnosis is difficult. Symptoms of pulmonary embolism mimic physiological changes of pregnancy. The key components of the pulmonary embolism don't really work as well as MRS translation with advanced imaging such as CT or VQ. The problem is when we use these, this has risks to the radiation, risk to the mother and the fetus. So here's all the different tools we use. Relative to here, it's just tools, pretest probability, and one blood test, D-dimer. The pregnancy, there's all different tools and all different ways we use them. Here's these seven guidelines I was talking about before. From start to finish, this is a little bit of a confusing chart and how it works. But the most important part is if you look at these seven major guidelines from around the world, they each have very different pathways to evaluate pulmonary embolism. And this is problematic for the patient as provider. When there's uncertainty, people do things in different ways and we don't really know what the best way is. So my main research focus is to figure out what is the best way to evaluate for this disease in pregnancy. Here's a recent review article looking at this topic. And we see that within each section, there's different guidelines that the count of how many guidelines recommend each step. With an ultrasound before advanced imaging, there's an even distribution between doing it, not doing it, and how to do it. When I do, I'm a radiologist, and there's distribution of what advanced imaging to use, or even distribution among indeterminate testing. But what's important to know is that guidelines are based on the best available data, but there could be limited how it evaluates things. For example, what I do is advanced imaging. This is my professional, what I do professionally. And there's two tests you could evaluate for in pregnancy for direct visualization of pulmonary embolism. Below is a CTPA and above is a VQ scan. This is a nuclear medicine scan and this is a regular CAT scan. All the guidelines have decided that nuclear medicine provides less radiation dose to the mother and therefore that's the best test to use. And we can see this here. They decided that's the best. But there's a lot of other factors to consider. Radiation dose to the fetus, the test characteristics, repeat studies, how often they happen, what are the total cost of it, what's the availability of the test. And really, even though they just considered radiation dose to the fetus, it's even more complex than that because even though the CT provides more radiation dose to the mother, fetal dose may be actually considered the same, which is important to consider. Or even some recent studies have suggested that CT could have a lower dose overall. So I think that all these things have to be looked at in a much deeper, more analytical path. Okay, so here is an example of exactly what I was trying to do. The guidelines vary significantly. So our goal is to improve outcomes by standardizing care because all these different guidelines create variations in care and suboptimal outcomes. Our hypothesis is one of these guidelines, the ATS-STR guidelines, the American guidelines, was the best for several reasons, including that it appropriately utilized imaging findings and deciding what test to use. It doesn't use an unproven test such as D-dimer that we talked briefly before. It's good for the general population around pregnancy, and it clearly defines follow-up for indeterminate results. And how we did this was a comprehensive decision model with multi-objective optimization. It's kind of innovative because we believe that it focuses on the outcomes of the mother and the fetus. It doesn't just compare one test, the CAT scan or VQ, what is better, but it compares entire diagnostic clinical pathways. And we think that this will determine the best practice and enable patients and providers to jointly enact informed decisions based on individualized predictable outcomes. So here's what we use to evaluate this. It's decision analytics. I don't know if any of you have heard of this, but decision analytics is something that accounts for different possible decisions one can make, the probability of events, and the outcomes from there. So here's an example, whether you should buy an umbrella or not, and the outcome is based on what happens if it rains. And here you have the choice to buy or not buy. There's a probability it rains, and there's a cost. So if you buy the umbrella, the cost is $20, and it's the same whether it rains or not. If you don't buy the umbrella, if there's a good rainy day, there's no cost. A good sunny day, there's no cost at all. But if it rains, you ruin your brand new clothing, and there's a cost there. So we believe if we transfer this to the case of pulmonary embolism, make this much more complex, include all the steps of what a patient and provider could do, then we could include all the potential choices, all the probabilities, and all the outcomes, and model the situation. One of the things we used here is our primary outcome is something called quality adjusted life year. This accounts for disease burden. Each health state a patient can be in is usually normal or healthy, disability and death. is rated from 0 to 1, with 1 being perfect health and 0 being death. The patients move throughout our complex models based on their starting state for here, it's whether they have a pulmonary embolism or not. And we use something called a discrete time Markov chain, which you see on the right, which doesn't just say it's just one state, but you could actually move back and forth between sunny, partly cloudy, rainy, and vice versa. It's a much more dynamic way to model these things. So here's the goals of the project I'm talking about. Today I'm going to be talking about step one primarily, develop a decision model to compare the 7 clinical guidelines and see what yields the highest outcomes for the mother and fetus. Future research we're working about is to modify this only for the mother only, the fetus only, and multi-weighted maternal fetal outcomes. So how did we do this? It was simple for the case of the umbrella, but here we're doing something much more complicated. So we built in a program called Triage, a very complex model that counts for every single step from these 7 guidelines, includes all type of thrombosis, like in the leg, we talked about DVT, and the chest is pulmonary embolism. Every single of those clinical tools mentioned on that first page includes all the imaging studies. Here we have CAT scan, nuclear medicine studies, ultrasound of the legs and chest x-ray, follow-up for indeterminate results, risk stratification, empiric therapy, which is when you treat the patient before you even know the diagnosis, because you want to, we talked earlier about the mortality is 1% with treatment and 30% without treatment. So here, we want to get a head start on treating them. And finally, that blood test called D-dimer. We have all these health states, whether it's a cost, disability, death, or normal state related to the pulmonary embolism, the defeats, thrombosis, treatment, and a clinical tool. And our outcome, as we talked about before, is quality-adjusted life years. We use Triage. We modeled every single one of these outcomes as seen before. Patients flow through this as they would in a normal clinical workflow, and doctors have to make certain decisions, and we grade those decisions. Here's all these different health states we take into account. In the short term, this health states in fact the mother and the fetus. In the short term, we have pulmonary embolism, which could cause, for example, disability, just cost, or even death. When you give a CAT scan versus a VQ scan, CAT scans give something called contrast, which will cause an allergy, which is anaphylaxis, or something to your kidneys called contrast-induced nephropathy. Your treatment is a blood thinner that's good for reducing mortality, but has risks of bleeding, which is hemorrhage and other risks. And finally, what's unique about our model is for the mother and the fetus, we don't take into account just short-term outcomes, as we talked about above, but we take into account long-term outcomes being recurrent or chronic pulmonary embolism, or radiation related to any of our tests, because the big fear in all this is radiation to the mother or the fetus, and which can cause cancer, and we model that into our study. And this is the overall big picture of what it looks like for our mothers going back and forth between these well states, pulmonary embolism states in this Markov model. They could go back and forth between death, disability, long-term states, et cetera. And this is a little more straightforward, what it looks like for the children. And the hardest part here was actually not setting it up, but finding how to get all the probabilities. In our model, we need over 180 probabilities that fell into several categories. In contrast, related to the test, costs, D-dimer is a blood test. And these aren't just probabilities or costs, how they work, but how effective they are, what the test characteristics are, how they work with other tests. And these are everything we've shown. And here's an example of it. Here's just the probabilities, proposed values with ranges related to imaging. What's important about decision value, you big explore range, and you run this through there. Here's the whole list, all 181. And we ran this through the model, and we actually found that the American guidelines, the ATS guidelines here, yielded the highest quality adjusted life years, although at the highest cost. There's 3 guidelines here. These are all dominated by these 3 guidelines. What does that mean to be dominated in the decision model? It means in our cost-effective analysis, it means that here, this is the highest outcomes, though the highest cost. This is the lowest cost, which has a value, and this is optimizing cost and value. But for all these, there's always something that is cheaper or something optimizing the cost value outcome proposition, or overall optimizing the overall outcomes. So once again, we found the ATS guidelines to be the best. after just finding out which is the best one, we want to do some more advanced analyses. So we perform discrete and probabilistic sensitivity analyses, and this gives us the ability to look at what the key factor, the top guideline better than the other guidelines. And here our ATS is the best one. This ANZOG is number two. And here's different scenarios that may favor one over the other. But this line over here is a very important line. This is the line that determines what actually is the best outcome. And only one of these factors at all changes what's the best outcome if you vary it to different numbers. You see that here. The ATS guideline is the best for every single factor in all the ways we ran this analysis, except when you have the prevalence of disease drop below 0.005. That's good to know. This is called a complex sensitivity analysis, and this is good to know where the points that one test may be better than the other. However, while there is a point where the ATS guideline is no longer the best strategy, this point to us is not clinically relevant because we estimate the probability of pulmonary embolism of someone who walks into an emergency department to be 0.05, 10 times higher than that. The lowest published studies were about 2%, so this is still much lower than that. So while there is a point where our best guideline is not the best, this falls out of the range of a clinically relevant point. But there were many challenges along the way, and the biggest challenge I would say in this is the fact that it's very hard to find data to input all these probabilities into this complex model. And over the way of doing this, two guidelines actually came out with newer additions. One of the new additions was completely vague, and we had to drop it because we could not decide what the guideline was recommending a clinician to do, let alone all the possible scenarios. And one other guideline recommended something we had never seen before. Instead of a test we had talked about, it recommended expert imaging review. And they said the experts would relook at all the images to decide what the right diagnosis is. And we'll talk more about that in a minute, how we dealt with that. And then finally, part two of this is how we deal with this maternal fetal dual outcome situation, which will be future work. If there's a variable we don't know what to do with, we perform sensitivity analysis on that variable. We, like we were talking about before, we pick a whole big range of possible ranges for that variable and see if it changes what's best. Over this whole range of these two variables, which is what's related to the expert opinion and how we put it into our model, the probability of experts make the right call when the patient has a PE, the probability of expert makes the wrong call when the patient has a PE. No matter what these values are, the ATS guidelines are the same. This sensitivity analysis has proven, while we don't have the most confident in exact number is, that our model is robust to this. So no matter what the number is, it decides what's best. Briefly, the next step here is to separately take out the maternal outcomes, the fetal outcomes, and look at them separately. We started to do this. One of the challenges we have currently is they're actually very, very similar, and we have to decide if that's a technical reason or there's something we're not accounting for when looking at the dual outcomes optimization, and that's our next step. In general, future steps include applying for future funding, coming up with a better algorithm to identify high versus low risk patients. And for this, we're going to look at large claims data to delineate the best pathway of diagnostic tools for high and low patients, not just among the seven guidelines, but to mix and match and come up with their own best guidelines. That we're going to continue with advanced decision modeling. And then finally, we really want to integrate this into our own system, whatever the best result is. And to do this, we're going to conduct interviews of key stakeholders and do some qualitative and quantitative research. So thank you so much. That's a brief overview of some of the work I've been working on, and I'd love to answer any questions that arise.